kind of some big, large programs to study galaxy evolution using some of the, like, I think the biggest publicly available infrared camera around, and kind of led the data analysis and then eventually the science analysis part of that program. And then she moved on after getting her PhD to a NASA postdoctoral fellowship program at Goddard Space Flight Center, and then got a Hubble Fellowship, which is a prestigious astronomy fellowship at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. And she recently got a faculty job at the University of Connecticut, where they're starting a new astronomy group. The reason I was doubtful the professor, she has the job, she's a professor, but she still has this wonderful benefit of not having to start teaching yet, so she's kind of still maintaining her fellowship status, but will be a professor at Connecticut soon. So it's really wonderful that Kate's here. She's going to be around tomorrow. Some of you have appointments with her, and there's also a seminar, so she'll be giving an additional talk tomorrow in the Astro Seminar. So without further ado, I'm going to let Kate have the floor to talk about the cosmic shutdown of star formation and galaxies, so I'm interested to hear it.
Thank you. So I'm getting over a cold, so I'll try my best to project, but if at any point you can't hear me, or also I like to be very interactive, so please feel free to stop me and ask questions. I enjoy it more when you guys interact with me throughout, so don't be afraid to stop me. So thank you, Greg, for that lovely introduction, and thank you all for having me here. I'm really excited. This is my first time to Kansas. It's pretty windy here, I've noticed, but it's lovely to see a new part of our country. So today I'm going to talk to you about my research in studying the cosmic shutdown of star formation. So I'll try not to get too doomsday on you, but studying the most massive galaxies in our universe and trying to understand why they form their stars so early and what shuts off their star formation. So to start, I always like to show this image that we see here in the background. And can anyone tell me, maybe guess what this is an image of, or just shout out something that you notice?
Milky Way.
Yes, there you go. So we see the Milky Way right here. So I often show this image, certainly giving talks a little bit closer to home, because most people do notice exactly that, that we see the Milky Way right here. But the reason that I like this picture, it's an actual photograph of a body of water in Massachusetts. And so if we look here, it's called the Quabbin Reservoir, so you can see it's not an insignificantly small, it's a very large body of water. And so at the surface, this could look like any other lake or reservoir in this case, but it holds a much richer history. And so about 75 years ago, the Swift River Valley had four towns, and they were disincorporated, and everybody was moved out, and over a seven-year span, they flooded this valley into what it is in the present day, which is the Quabbin Reservoir, which is the drinking water supply for Boston to this day. And so, you know, when you look at this image at the surface, you wouldn't know that. So much like when we study our universe and when we study galaxies, when we look at galaxies and we see a snapshot in time, the tricky part is figuring out where did that galaxy come from and what happened in its history to get it to its present day characteristics. so if we, you know, one of, okay, so if we focus back here on the Milky Way and back into the astronomy realm here, a changing point, I think, for studying galaxy formation and evolution happened around 20 years ago when we decided to take the Hubble Space Telescope and point at a region of space that was no bigger than a grain of rice held at arm's length and stare for the longest integration yet. And the image that we got of the cosmos is, to this day, my favorite image, mostly because of how it changed the field and how things progressed. So if we zoom in at a region of space, we see here the iconic Hubble Deep Field. And what you'll notice is, so again, this is a very tiny patch of sky, and it was a really a big risk. So we took Hubble and we observed for 10 consecutive days, the longest integration at that time ever. And they had no, I say they because I wasn't actually an astronomer yet. So I'll broadly jump ahead there. I'll say we had no idea what we were going to find. And so in this image, there are three Milky Way stars. That means that all nearly 3,000 other objects in here are galaxies. And you can see that galaxies come in different shapes. They come in different sizes, different colors. There's a large diversity of properties of galaxies. And it was really at this point that how Hubble was being used changed. And so it made room for this idea of having large, ambitious programs to sort of drive the field and to push to earlier times in the universe and understand more and deeper insight into galaxy formation and evolution. So if we look in a cosmic timeline shown here, the study of galaxy formation and evolution, it's concerned with the processes from which we form a heterogeneous universe from a nearly homogeneous beginning. So galaxies form as a result of tiny quantum fluctuations in the aftermath of the Big Bang, and in our current framework, the lambda cold dark matter cosmology tells us that it's the clustering and the merging of dark matter halos that governs how galaxies get their shape and their mass, and determines their shape and their structure. So I would argue it's really the baryonic physics which tells us about gas collapse, how we form stars, how do black holes form, all of these processes, how does gas flow into galaxies, how does gas flow out of galaxies. This is really currently the main bottleneck in understanding galaxy formation and evolution at present. And so what I do as an observational extragalactic astronomer is use these large surveys, large statistical samples of galaxies, where you have an image, you take just much like the Hubble Deep Field, and the hardest part is figuring out that third dimension of where do all of these different galaxies with this vast array of properties belong in space-time. So effectively, our telescope is like a time machine because light travels at the speed of light. So the longer it's been traveling, the further back in time we're looking. And so my job is figuring out over most of cosmic time, billions of years of cosmic time, how have the properties of galaxies changed, and more importantly, why? What is the physics driving this evolution? So the excuse me, the outline of my talk. First, I'm going to give you a very broad overview of what I mean when I say that I'm measuring a galaxy color, the physics of galaxy color, and talk about our expanding universe and in the context of how we search for large statistical samples of distant galaxies and how do we find distant galaxies. The two science questions that I wanted to touch on today are first answering when does star formation quench? So I mentioned that I study the most massive galaxies and trying to understand when star formation shuts down. So when is this happening? How far back in time do we need to look? And then how are galaxies growing in cosmic time? And so when I say how are they growing, one could interpret that in many different ways, but I mean in the context of size and how are they getting their, we see the galaxies get larger later in time, and so how is that happening and why? Okay, so I always like to start with this image because if you knew nothing else and if you read none of the words on this slide, you would see that there's two different types of galaxies here. And the main things that we could tell with no other prior knowledge is that they have a different color, right? One's blue, one's red, and they have different structure. One has a very smooth light profile, and one has a spiral disc-like structure. And so it's really the underlying properties of the stellar populations. And so when I say stellar populations, I mean all the stars that comprise each individual galaxy that make up why we see this color and why we see this structure. So in this case over here, there's young stellar populations and there's abundant cold gas. So gas is the fuel of star formation. And when you have cold gas, you can form new stars. Whereas down here, elliptical galaxies generally have very old stellar populations and they have little to no gas, certainly little to no cold gas, because they haven't had recent star formation. And so the next few slides going through is really going through the background for probably some or most of you, it may well be a review, but everybody likes to hear something they know, so bear with me. And hopefully it'll keep all of us on the same page of understanding when I show you a galaxy spectrum, what we're looking at. So this is the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram showing on this axis is surface temperature increasing as a function of luminosity. And so we have the main sequence of star formation where stars are spending most of their lifetime. So now we're not talking about galaxies, we're talking about the individual stars that make up these galaxies. And stars spend most of their lifetime fusing hydrogen to helium in this phase. And so if we look at the most luminous main sequence stars, we see up here that these are also the most massive stars. And so these stars are incredibly luminous, incredibly massive, and they burn their fuel fast and furious, so they have very short lifetimes. If we go down to less luminous, less massive, longer lived stars. You see that, we'll come back to this particular star. We call this, in astronomers, we like to use acronyms and letters and numbers, so bear with me, but these would be A-type stars. And these stars have lifetimes of about 1 billion years. And they're about 3 times the mass of our sun. This is where our sun lives here, with a lifetime of about 10 billion years. The sun's about halfway through its lifetime, so that's good. Nothing drastic will happen in our lifetimes. And then down here we have low mass stars, and they have lifetimes, so any low mass star that ever formed in our universe is still fusing hydrogen to helium on the main sequence. So did anybody see the press release recently about the 7 Earth-sized planets discovered? So they were discovered around this type of a star, so a very low mass, long-lived star, which is an exciting field in and of itself. But you're stuck hearing about galaxies today. Okay, so if we actually look at the spectra of these different types of stars, you see that the most massive stars, so this is now showing the most massive luminous to least massive luminous, so blue to red, these are blue stars, and you can see they are blue because most of the light that they emit is in the rest frame ultraviolet. That's where they see their features. And then when I told you that the special, when a star that has a main sequence lifetime of around 1 billion years, the most prominent feature are these Balmer series, these lines of hydrogen transitions. And you can see it's very prominent in their spectrum. Whereas when you go down to these longer-lived, redder, low-mass stars, most of their light is emitted at longer, redder wavelengths. And so this is important because when we look at a galaxy, we can't see the individual stars. We only see the integrated light of all the stars that make up that galaxy. And so shown here next is a spectrum of a star-forming galaxy, a typical spectrum. And what you would notice is first, we see this upturn of ultraviolet radiation. And this is because there is recent star formation and there are these short-lived, very massive stars that are dominating the ultraviolet light. So it's these guys up here that have, they're very luminous, they dominate the light in the galaxy, but they don't live very long. So you have to have had recent star formation to have this rest frame ultraviolet light. The next most prominent feature is what we call the Balmer break. And so again, this is from these A-type stars, lifetimes of about 1 billion years. So this is for a star-forming galaxy. If I were to show you the spectrum next of a quiescent galaxy, so when I say quiescent, I mean something that is no longer forming stars, hasn't formed stars in recent years. This is shown here. And so first, what you'll notice is there's essentially no rest frame ultraviolet radiation. And this is, again, because it stopped forming stars. You don't have those short-lived massive stars dominating the rest frame ultraviolet. But the other thing you'll notice is that it peaks at a slightly redder wavelength, which we call the 4,000 angstrom break. And this is due to these accumulation of metals in the atmosphere of these low-mass stars. So we can take advantage of these properties of galaxies and the stars that make up galaxies to understand the stellar populations when we go out and measure an integrated spectrum of a galaxy. So if I define here, this is all circling around to what is the color of a galaxy. And so when we define color, we're effectively taking the ratio of the fluxes in two different filters for a galaxy. So you see here, for example, of a red galaxy, it's emitting a lot more light, relatively speaking, at a redder wavelength, and therefore it has a red color. And conversely, it's not as prominent of a difference for this star-forming galaxy. And so when we look as astronomers at this color, so here I'm talking about the U minus V color, and I pick this color intentionally because it's straddling that most prominent feature for quiescent galaxies, which is this 4,000 angstrom break, Balmer break region. And so when we look at this U minus V color, which is the optical color, of galaxies as a function of the stellar mass, we see an interesting bimodality. And so this is observed in the nearby universe, shown here. This is data taken from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. And so you see now the color of a galaxy as a function of stellar mass. So now we're talking about all the stars in that galaxy. And you see that there's a bimodality and that there is this tight red sequence of galaxies formed up here, and then what we call a blue cloud. And not too many galaxies actually live in between. Galaxies tend to live in one of two camps. And so the question is why? Why is this so tight? What are these galaxies? And then you'll also notice that the most massive galaxies are almost exclusively red. You have very few that have blue. And so if you think back to what I was just telling you about why, how do galaxies get the colors that they get, very little blue means very little star formation, if we trace it back, recent star formation. So indeed, if we look at observations of nearby red galaxies in the local universe, we see that they are indeed red and dead. This is showing an example here of very deep, so the background image is an extremely deep ground-based imaging of nearby elliptical galaxies, red galaxies, and you see if you go to very low surface brightnesses, these very broad tidal features, these fans of stars, and that's telling us something really important that I'll get back to at the very end of my talk about how these galaxies are forming and how they're growing their mass. But the other thing is, if we use Hubble and look with higher resolution in at the centers of these galaxies, we notice that they have indeed light color profiles, I guess, consistent with just being red and dead, quiescent, no recent star formation, kind of boring. So before moving on, I have one I wanted to highlight. So I have a UConn student who's currently working on this very problem of looking at these tidal features. And so these were extremely deep images that were taken in the nearby universe of these galaxies. But as we go back in time and look, galaxies get fainter and fainter, and it becomes really hard to measure these very faint tidal features. And so he's studying the detectability of tidal features and how much larger of a telescope would we need and more sensitive a telescope to be able to detect, robustly to detect tidal features at earlier times in the universe. But these galaxies had to have formed their stars at some point. They had to. If we can look further back in time, we should see an epoch where all of these massive, all galaxies effectively should be forming their stars, because we see that they have built up their mass. So the next part of my talk is trying to lead into how do we find samples of distant galaxies and look further back in time. Okay, so we all know that the universe, that space itself is expanding. So if you think in the context of finding distant galaxies, if we're sitting here and we're in this galaxy over here, we're going to later have our telescope waiting to catch the photons on our detector, and we want to detect the light from this galaxy over here, as that light is emitted, it's traveling through space to reach us, and because space itself is expanding, the light is being stretched due to cosmological redshift. And so by the time it reaches us at our telescope, it is seen at a longer wavelength. And so this is really important in the context of finding distant galaxies. So put in another way, this is showing the spectrum of an elliptical galaxy, and we see that most of its light is emitted in the rest frame optical. So this is defined to be a redshift of zero, which means we're at the present day age of the universe, 13.7 billion years. And so we're going to tick up in redshift, which means we tick up in look back time and are looking at a younger, earlier, down at the age of the universe. We're looking at earlier times, earlier and earlier times in our universe. And so if we let this go, what you see is by the time we get to a redshift of one, about half the age of the universe, this peak has completely shifted into the near infrared. And so studying the early universe and studying galaxies in the first half of our universe effectively, you would never have detected in an optical selected survey, you would never have detected these distant, we never would have been sensitive to these galaxies because all their light has been redshifted into the near infrared. And so it's really the reason that we haven't been able to, that's really changed in the last decade or more of studying distant galaxies is because of near infrared technology and because of improvements of having really sensitive, wide area near infrared cameras. And so there's two problems. There's always problems, right? But the two further problems is that dust becomes a problem in identifying galaxies, which I'll talk about next. And then also, the further back in time we look, galaxies become fainter and fainter. So it becomes more challenging to get that third dimension, as well as to figure out thereby the color, get accurate colors and properties of these galaxies. So first, more dusty galaxies. So I wanted to take a brief moment to highlight some very recent work that I'll talk about in far more detail tomorrow. But the takeaway I wanted to present here, so this is a plot showing the fraction of star formation in a galaxy that's obscured by dust. So it's this axis is the fraction, then it's a function of stellar mass. And so what I want to highlight is that it's a strong function of mass. And you see that the most massive things have almost all of their star formation obscured by dust. They're very dusty, and this dust is absorbing most of the ultraviolet light from those massive galaxies. So if we just look here at what mass would half of the starlight be seen as obscured versus unobscured, you see this is a modestly low stellar mass. So anything more massive, certainly these are considered massive galaxies. This would be considered intermediate mass. And then by the time you get down to 10 to the 9, that's maybe started to consider it a lower mass galaxy. So most galaxies have star formation obscured by dust. So we have to be able to take into account dust. So what happens when you have dust? I showed you before this blue SED here, which has this ultraviolet radiation due to recently formed young massive stars. So say you were to take a star-forming galaxy and we see it as face-on. It may be that we happen to see it as edge-on, so we look through the edge of a disk, so we're looking through a thicker dust column. Or it could be that you're looking at a galaxy that just happened to have a recent major merger and it doesn't have the structure, it's just a very big dusty mess of star formation. In either case, what would happen is that light from recently formed stars is going to be absorbed by the dust in the galaxy and re-radiated at longer wavelengths outside of this plot. And so you change the shape of the spectral energy distribution of these galaxies, of the spectrum of them. And so you see here that a dusty galaxy has a much, very little rest frame ultraviolet, most of it's being absorbed and re-radiated, and it has a gradual slope. If I show you my spectrum of a quiescent galaxy, I hope you now see why that's a problem. So if we use our U minus V color here, they have very similar colors to something that is inherently very different. Something that is red and dead, hasn't formed recent stars, and something that's probably the most vigorously star-forming dusty galaxies in the universe. So one way that we can overcome this is by adding in, so I've only shown you two, we're only sampling at 2 points in the spectrum so far with these two colors. If we add in another filter at so this is an optical color, and if we look at an optical to infrared color, you can see that we can start to see differences again in these galaxies. And so the next plot I'm going to show you, which will come back again and again in my talk, so this is why we're having a long lead into what this is, but it's a color plot. It's showing the optical color, so the ratio of these fluxes as a function of the ratio of these fluxes. And it's a really powerful observational tool to be able to identify robustly star forming generically, whether there is dust or not, from quiescent galaxies. So shown here is the color plot, the UV color as a function of VJ. And we see that quiescent galaxies live up in this parameter space. These are shown with Hubble Space Telescope images, little stamps. And down here, we see a sequence of star-forming galaxies, where galaxies in this corner are relatively, you can just see by eye, they have relatively blue colors, often they're face-on. And this is, if you increase the amount of dust in the galaxy, this is the vector along which galaxies have more and more dust as they go up here. And so, again, these are quiescent up here, and either dusty star-forming or unobscured star-forming. And this is a tool that we use to study galaxies across time. If you want to understand how the quiescent population formed, it formed at some point from a star-forming population, you first need to identify the statistics across time. And this is a really powerful tool to be able to do that in a clean way. So I'm going to show you now a color plot as a function of time, as we look back to earlier times in the universe. So again, as a reminder, these are quiescent galaxies up here, and these are star-forming galaxies. And you see, just like we saw in the color mass diagram, we see this bimodality at the lowest redshifts here. And we can see that this bimodality persists as we look up to earlier and earlier times. So by the time we get to above a redshift of 2, so this is looking back over 10 billion years in time, so the universe is only a few billion years old at this point, we see that we lose this bimodality. And so the question is, have we looked far enough back in time such that there are no quiescent galaxies, everything is star forming, nothing has yet shut off, or is it because we have a really large uncertainty and we have no idea what we're actually looking at when we look this far back in time? So the next part of my talk is I'll be introducing two different techniques that I've been involved in trying to get more accurate distances and therefore colors and properties of distant galaxies for statistical samples across time. So the idea is to really improve this error bar right here and see what can we learn about galaxies once you are able to get these samples. Do I have everyone with me? Yeah? Okay, good. So it's my pleasure to talk about a survey, the NUFIRM Medium Band Survey, which was the core of my thesis. Now I guess it's starting to get aged, but it'll never be old to me. So this is a survey where we looked at two regions of the sky. So Peter Van Dokken, my thesis advisor, is the PI of this, and you'll notice Mr. Gregory Rudnick, who is a co-I and a really great mentor and advisor to me as a graduate student, trying to figure out what I would do with 75 nights of data. Well, I shouldn't say 75 nights, right? Half of it was weathered out. So roughly 35 nights of data, and a lot of nights spent in a telescope not taking data. But in this survey, we pointed at two very well-studied extragalactic fields. They're about the size of the moon, each of them, so shown here for reference. And the idea was that, so if I show you here now, the idea was to combine, this is what we were adding, with existing, so these are well-studied existing fields. They have, these are Spitzer, deep Spitzer imaging, and this is optical imaging. And what we did was fabricate medium band near infrared filters. So we took the standard broadband filter and created multiple filters that were narrower out of these filters to sample the spectral energy distributions at a higher spectral resolution. And so this animation down here pretty much encapsulates, to me, the power of this. And so these are, because they're in the near infrared, they're really targeting distant galaxies, galaxies that are above greater than at least a redshift of 1. And so what we're going to see is that redshift is going to tick up, and then you see where you're sampling, where in the rest frame are you sampling of these galaxies. So on the left is our standard J and H filters, and on the right are the medium band filters. And what you can see is, again, by the time we get to redshift 1.5, you see these medium band filters popping up and down and really sampling with higher spectral resolution to get, therefore, more accurate distances of this most prominent feature of galaxies above a redshift of 1.5, where all of the data sort of petered out before in the previous plot. So it's a lot more, it's a powerful tool by only adding an additional, if you will, 3 images or 3 data points for any given galaxy. Okay, so with this, on the left is shown an example individual spectrum from our survey of an old galaxy, and on the right is a relatively young, dusty galaxy. And so you can see that this is now normalized at 1 micron, but you can see that the dusty galaxy, we can really tell the difference here. Dusty galaxies have a much more gradual slope, whereas old galaxies, it turns back over again. It's sharper and has a stronger 4,000 angstrom break. And so if we return to what I showed you before, remember by the time we got to a redshift of 2, we lost this bimodality. You would see here that these galaxies, though they have very similar U minus V colors, they'd have very different colors in this ratio of flux at the longer wavelengths. Okay, so if we return here and we're going to focus on this panel here, what do we see with the NUFIRM medium band survey? So what we found, again, just to wow you with the improvement that we had with the survey, not only do we observe this bimodality at a redshift of above 2, but we observed it above, out to a redshift of 3. So this is getting really interesting. We're seeing evidence for quiescent galaxies that are incredibly massive, formed their stars very early in the universe, really butting up against what is possible with theoretical models to form that early in the universe, and have already shut down their star formation and appear to be red and dead. And the universe, again, is only a few billion years old at this point. So I think that this is not only a powerful tool to have more accurate, there's in any one of those pointings, there was about 10,000 galaxies that are above a redshift of 1. So it's a really large sample of distant galaxies, but also to have the power to separate out star-forming and quiescent galaxies. And then the fun part of trying to then take it to the next level of understand how these properties, how their numbers are changing, how their masses are changing, and how are their physical properties changing across time. Okay, so for the remainder of my talk, we'll come back to the color diagram, but really we're using this diagnostic to be able to separate out across cosmic time those galaxies that are star forming from those that are quiescent. Yes, a question.
Yeah, so you've got a signal here in the variables you chose to use, U, V, and DJ.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot more points, so you have better data. So why wouldn't you follow up on different linear combinations or different cuts and regions on this data to bring out this signal a little better? It would just be a pure accident if U minus V and V minus J were the optimal variables in a large data set with a lot of...
So I'll maybe rephrase your question. When you have a full, beautiful data set that has something like 40 filters, why are you picking three? Maybe is one way to say it. And I'll come back to that actually in a few slides because you're completely correct. So I think as astronomers, we try to find the easiest way to be able to what's the quick diagnostic tool. And so studying distant galaxies started by using only three filters. And it's really evolved in the last decade to having these surveys having 40 filters in them. And you're completely correct that, A, I'm glossing over the detail that a lot more data went into actually making this measurement. It's not just two filters. But B, there is a lot more information that could be learned. So I'll get to that. Excellent question. Okay, so in getting to that, I want to return to my science questions that I wanted to answer. And the first question was, when does star formation quench? So how far back in time do we need to look until we see the epoch where most of these massive galaxies are rapidly shutting off their star formation? And so, leading into the fact that we're missing out on more information, if we look at this color diagram and focus only on the quiescent region, we saw an interesting trend when you model this data of looking at the typical ages of these galaxies from this photometric survey. And so what we saw was an age sequence where it seemed consistent with galaxies that have, so these are all quiescent galaxies, but galaxies that have relatively blue colors amongst the quiescent population tended to have ages consistent with about 1 billion years. And then this was a vector here of aging along this sequence. So we saw evidence that age was driving this color sequence that we saw within the quiescent population. And the reason that this is powerful is because if you want to understand what is quenching star formation, you have to be able to identify those galaxies that just recently shut off. So you want to be able to tell galaxies that have been red and dead for a really long time versus those that just recently shut off and try to actually look for the observational clues by separating out recently quenched galaxies. And so if we look here, this is telling us perhaps that we can use a simple diagnostic like these two colors to actually identify robustly recently quenched galaxies. And so within this data set, as just mentioned by John, we're really throwing out a lot of information that we can really leverage because it's a large statistical sample. So next I'm going to talk to you about how you can take images and make spectroscopy, right? Make wine out of water. So we have these images with about 10,000 distant galaxies, and the trick here is that every galaxy is at a slightly different redshift, so it's sampling a slightly different rest frame wavelength for any given filter. And so what we do is if you can select what you think are a sample of analogs, so galaxies that you think have similar properties, you can use, if you have a large enough sample, you can actually make a low resolution spectrum from the imaging. So if we take shown here are two different galaxies, and they each have their own redshift. They're each at a slightly different time in the universe. So we deredshift them and shift them into the rest frame. So now we've deredshifted them, and we scale them to unity at a given wavelength. And then we repeat this for all analogs in our sample that we're considering, shown here. And then we take a running median, and what you can see is that you get effectively a spectrum, a low resolution spectrum of this galaxy. And the beautiful thing here is that it's completely empirical. I have not relied on any models to try to the data tells me what the data tells me. I haven't. It's literally just what the observations are. Yeah.
Cherry picked which galaxies go into.
So the key is trying to figure out how to pick analogs. And so a colleague of mine has done a lot of work within the color-color diagram of looking at analogs in color-color space. So across that entire diagram, actually the spectra that I showed you in the beginning, the blue for star forming, red, and the purple is actually from this data set by looking as a function of color-color space, so purely empirical. But in this case, what I wanted to do was to look and use this technique to look at the what I think are recently quenched galaxies, so those with the bluest UV colors within the quiescent region, and compare it to what I think are older galaxies, and see if we see a low-resolution composite spectrum that is consistent with this. Before moving on, I wanted to also mention that you can sometimes get emission lines from your composite spectra of imaging, so it's really a fun thing, technique that developed, and part of the power here is because we have in this data set, medium band, so slightly higher spectral resolution data that's going into this that can allow for you to have resolve, not quite wash out, I guess, all the features that you might see. So shown here is now making a composite spectrum for color-color selected galaxies that I want to call recently quenched and what I want to call older. And what we see, and then models are shown down here. And this is a model, the blue model is for something, a stellar population of about a billion years old. So about roughly a billion years ago, something happened, shut off star formation, and it hasn't been forming stars for about a billion years. Whereas this is consistent with an older galaxy. For simplicity, let's say it's about 2 billion years old. So it's been aging for longer. And beyond about 1 billion years, very rapidly, the spectrum of a galaxy looks sort of, it doesn't change very much. So there's this sweet spot between around a billion years where you can, there's a rapid evolution in the spectral features that we observe because of these A-type stars that I mentioned in the beginning that are going to rapidly evolve off the main sequence around then. Okay. So everything I showed you so far is based on imaging. And you might be a little bit dubious because really what we would like, the golden standard would be spectroscopy and getting spectroscopic features and getting spectroscopic confirmation of the ages of these galaxies to see if this technique really works. So in the next part, I'll be talking about Hubble Space Telescope data that I've been using and been a part of to try to push this question and a little bit further and see what we can learn. So why Hubble? So my favorite analogy for Hubble is that it's basically like, this is a ground-based color, three-color image, and using Hubble is like putting on your glasses. So we can see galaxies with much higher clarity. We can see that they're, you know, much higher resolution, and where we really gain is not only in resolution, we can go much deeper. It's incredibly deep images, beautiful images that come from Hubble. And also, because there is a grism mode possible, you can actually get spectral information for this data. So I'm going to talk about data that is taken in the candles field. These are five extragalactic fields. I showed you the Hubble deep field in the beginning. That's one small pointing here. and so this is a really, this is, it's hard to put this into words to do justice, but these five extragalactic fields are the largest investment ever of Hubble. Over 3,000 orbits of Hubble have gone at various wavelengths, all the wavelengths pretty much that Hubble can observe at, all of the modes that Hubble can observe in have gone into studying these five extragalactic fields. So it's really, it's called a treasury program for a reason, and it's a beautiful resource for teaching as well as for continued research projects. And so my involvement, I believe you're part of Candles, right? You're not? Okay. Well, neither am I. So I'm not actually on the Candles team, but I'm on a team that took these fields, and what we did was use the grism mode to get spectroscopy. So if we have, this is the 3DHST team, and so this is showing, this was a 248 program, a large program survey with Hubble, and so each of these yellow boxes is one pointing of Hubble, and so this is showing the direct image, and using the grism, we disperse the light, this near-infrared light, and get a near-infrared spectrum for every object in the field. So this is now showing.
What does grism mean again?
It's effectively you're putting a prism in front and dispersing the light for all objects, and it'll have a finite, so we'll get to the wavelength coverage in a second. But you're making a spectrum for, you're just, it's adding a dispersive element instead of a standard filter that blocks out, say, for imaging. So, The beautiful thing is that we get a spectrum for everything in the field. And the scary thing is that we get a spectrum for everything in the field. And so you have no way, it's not slit spectroscopy, everything overlaps. And so contamination is a really challenging thing to deal with these types of data.
Because the light from one star.
Yeah, so you can have, you can see already that, well, certainly this would be a train wreck right here, but when you have something bright, and say it happens to be next to something very faint that you wanted to measure, unfortunately, it depends on which angle you were looking at it, but the world doesn't always conspire to get the best data. Nonetheless, we persisted. So this is showing an example of a direct image of a quiescent galaxy at a redshift of 1. And so you see it's 2D spectrum. This spectrum is not very contaminated. This next down is removing the very little contamination that existed. And then you model the continuum and subtract that, and you would be left with emission lines, but this is doesn't have emission lines. It's only got absorption features. What you can see here relative to this other photometry, these beautiful data sets that you get from Kindle and other many ground-based efforts that have gone into these 5 extragalactic, well-intentioned, purposely picked fields, that it's a pretty narrow near-infrared wavelength range, but it's powerful because it's adding actual spectral information. And so now I'm showing you another individual example, now out a redshift of almost 2, so now looking back 10 billion years, and what you can see for this one single galaxy, that we actually see absorption features. We see magnesium, you see Balmer lines, you see probably most prominently, you see a 4,000 angstrom break. And so we can use this to fit it with a model, the stellar populations, and learn about the ages and actual spectral properties of this galaxy. But this is probably the brightest quiescent galaxy in the universe in the data, and this is your best case right here. So 3D HST was an emission line survey. It's really focused on star-forming galaxies, not on these continuum-only galaxies, certainly when you get out to these high redshifts because they're very faint. So these are objects that are really at the limit of the survey. But my involvement was looking and trying to see what we could get out of quiescent galaxies from 3D HST and trying to see if we could measure ages from them. So next I'm showing you a composite GRISM spectrum of a sample of about 200 quiescent galaxies around a redshift of 2. And so the beautiful thing is that we very clearly measure absorption features in these galaxies, and you can use these absorption features to age date these galaxies. And overall, quiescent galaxies at a redshift of 2. So again, the universe is only a few billion years old, are consistent with having shut off, where does the age, about 1.3 billion years ago on average. Another cute thing that came out of this, if you look closely,
1.3 billion years before.
Yeah, so at a redshift of 2, already at that point, 1.3 billion years earlier, so something like a redshift of 3, 3.5-ish. I'm not very good at doing that in my head. So the other interesting thing that we saw, if you look here, is that we saw emission line features in these quiescent, apparently quiescent dead galaxies. And then this Balmer line is also filled in. And so we saw H-beta and O3 in emission, and it's centrally concentrated. And so when I say centrally concentrated, the reason, so the line profile, the line width in GRISM spectroscopy is dominated by the morphology of an object. So if you had O3 in emission, say it was due to star formation, and it's happening over the entire galaxy, it would be spread over the morphology of the galaxy, and it would have looked something like this line down here. But we see very centrally concentrated, you see the two peaks pretty clearly, and that's telling us something that, so within the point spread function, or within the center, something that we're not resolving of the galaxy, is where we're seeing these features. And so, did you say wow? I love when I get a wow. So it's really fun because it's saying that we don't know why we're seeing O3 and H-beta in emission, but the two ideas are either that you're seeing evidence for a supermassive black hole, and perhaps that could either be related to quenching, or why the gas, if there is gas, is being kept hot in these galaxies, or maybe there is residual central star formation that we're missing. And so this is sort of an ongoing question, and that we'll make headway in this, but not today, unfortunately.
Do you have equivalent width measurements for the O2? I know it's hard to do.
No.
Stack?
No.
Like ballpark, no?
No. Well, I'm trying to think if...
Like 125.
I don't think that we could get... So for all the processing also that you've done to this, I don't think I tried to make that. So I did... estimate, if it were an AGN, the luminosity of the AGN, and I can't even remember off the top of my head, okay, however many years later. But I did do the actual experiment of, if this were an AGN, how luminous of an AGN would it be? And it would actually be something moderately luminous, but maybe even consistent with a liner, okay, which is not unrealistic for a radio mode type AGN, for a very detailed answer. So I wanted to use this technique, kind of circling back to recently quenched and older galaxies, to look at the composite spectra of these two populations. So recently quenched, these are our sample from 3D HST, and we have a lot more older, what I'm calling older, right? It's my hypothesis, I'm trying to test that. So when we look at the composite, this is the actual composite spectra, Grissom spectra, for what I think are recently quenched and older galaxies. And again, we saw evidence here where you see, so if I show the model, I guess it's sometimes easier to guide the eye, where you'd see stronger magnesium in an older stellar population, whereas you'd see stronger H-beta would be a stronger emission line, because that's that Balmer line that's due to A-type stars that have lifetimes of about a billion years. So those lines really peak when you're looking at a recently quenched galaxy, which makes it, and they quickly disappear as that galaxy ages. So you can see a prominent difference between, even between at that epoch in the universe, something that is just shy of a billion years old and something that's about 1.5 billion years old. So we seem to be seeing evidence that that we can identify based on colors recently quenched galaxies. And I'm going to continue, I guess. I'm going kind of slow here, so I apologize. But I have a student currently working with a beautiful data set, the Legacy data set, which is really now, I've shown you imaging, and I tried to make low resolution spectroscopy from imaging, and then I showed you composite spectra where I was stacking a bunch of stuff. And so this is now at a slightly lower redshift, but actually beautiful. So if any of you have ever looked at spectra from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, this is actual spectra from this survey, but it looks like the quality of Sloan-type spectra, but at a redshift of 1, so half the age of the universe. And so there's a large team of really hardworking, talented people, and I've, I guess, been sort of taking advantage of just the final data product and having a student look at this question. And so my student, Rochelle, this is now showing a color diagram, and it's color-coded by the strength of that 4,000 angstrom break, which is an age diagnostic. The stronger the 4,000 angstrom break, the older a galaxy is. And so you see the sequence, like we thought, but the interesting thing that I found from looking at this is that this other population of galaxies that look like they're recently quenched that would be missed, so kind of closer to that transition region. So there's perhaps two pathways in color space through quenching, and perhaps it's related to a time scale of how quickly does the quenching happening, where galaxies that go enter from down here have very rapid quenching, and over here would be consistent of a slower, more gradual quenching happening in these galaxies. And we can only ever get a snapshot of time. This has shown the actual 2D spectra from this full sample, and the thing that I'm still trying to digest is why we see O2 faintly, but more prominently in the bluest things. So we're still working on trying to understand this and see what we can get from this data. But the punchline, I wanted to know, when does star formation quench? So assuming that we can identify recently quenched and older galaxies, this is the number density evolution, so the number per unit volume as a function of time of old galaxies and how they're building up over time. And so you can use this to predict, given that buildup, how many recently quenched galaxies would I have to be adding to explain this population building up. This is the line right here, and we can actually go and look at the observations and how many recently quenched galaxies we observe, and it's relatively consistent. Down here, there's only 1, 2, and 3 galaxies, so you're getting pretty small number statistics there. But the key point is, by a redshift of 2, roughly half of quiescent galaxies just recently shut off their star formation. So redshift 2 is really important for massive galaxies and trying to understand the quenching of star formation. So I've answered my first question, and the next section is not nearly as long, so don't worry. Massive galaxies are rapidly shutting down around a redshift of 2. And so the next question I wanted to talk about is this puzzle that I'm still sort of working through understanding of, how do galaxies grow over cosmic time? And this is the size of galaxies as a function of stellar mass. And when we look at, this is local galaxies, and these are distant galaxies. And so galaxies of the same mass are a factor of 5 smaller. So this would be like taking, if you wanted to look at a distant galaxy, like taking all the stars in our Milky Way and squishing them into our bulge. The universe would look completely different. Shown here is what we look like if we're on the moon looking at Earth and your night sky in a distant galaxy. You'd have a lot more stuff packed into the same volume. You'd have a much brighter night sky. So if we look at the size evolution of star-forming galaxies, when you look back in time, so this is size evolution for star-forming galaxies looking back in redshift, it's not surprising that all galaxies on average get a little bit smaller. The universe was denser. Galaxies formed at earlier epochs are going to be a little bit smaller. So if you want to explain the interplay between a quiescent population and the star-forming population, if you're continuously shutting off star-forming galaxies and you're adding them to a quiescent population, you would, and doing nothing else to them, you would expect that there would be some correlation here. So if we take this and we're going to shut off galaxies roughly a billion years later, so it's not entirely, it's a smaller vector here because of how redshift is defined, these are going to appear as a quiescent galaxy. So this might be your predicted size evolution. So something a little bit smaller than star-forming galaxies, but not that much smaller. If we actually look at what we observe, this was pretty surprising. Quiescent galaxies at any given epoch in the universe are incredibly compact, especially in the distant universe, and they're much smaller than their star-forming progenitors at any given epoch. So if we focus at a redshift of 2, they're about a factor of 5 denser, smaller, squishing more stars into a smaller volume. And so you can see that this is, there's a distribution, so this is just looking at the average, and there is a tail here that we see of compact star-forming galaxies, but is it enough to actually explain the buildup of this compact galaxy population, and does this make sense? So putting this together into a picture here, we have this idea of how you form, so let's start here. We have a compact galaxy, and so I'm going to talk about this tomorrow, so I'm not going to go into any details about it now, but we see evidence that galaxies are compact, I'll talk about why or how we think that might happen tomorrow. We see evidence here that minor mergers and accretion appear to be important when we take these really deep images I showed you at the very beginning, and you see these tidal features that's showing evidence that you're puffing up these galaxies because they live in the center of their gravitational potential well, so they're going to tend to be those beasts that eat everything else up. And perhaps that's how they evolve into, which I just missed, into the local elliptical, large local ellipticals in the present day. But the thing we don't yet understand is what if any one of these, or if not all of these pathways, is most important for forming compact galaxies. This would be the early formation scenario where you just form incredibly early in the universe where everything was very dense. You form a very compact galaxy that lived in a relatively undisturbed dark matter halo. Not much happened to it. And then these two formation theories are effectively inducing some sort of central starburst that changes the structure of a galaxy to make it from something larger to something more compact. So I'm not going to answer my question, but I'll talk about future prospects. So how do galaxies grow over time? So we find compact galaxies. We have a pretty good census of the universe. We see how their sizes are evolving, but we really don't yet understand how these two populations are directly linked together and what is the story there. So a look towards what I'm interested in, have been working on lately, is first, if we look at the Illustris simulation, is a hydrodynamic cosmological simulation, and the beautiful thing about Illustris is it produces mock galaxies. It makes a mock universe much like Hubble, what we observe with Hubble. And so there's this beautiful work by Sarah Wellens that's looking at massive galaxies, and she finds samples she can produce in her simulations, these compact massive galaxies, and as well as extended. If we just focus on the compact galaxies, what is great about a simulation is that I don't just have a snapshot in time. I can actually tell how did that galaxy form? What pathway did it take to get to it? And so what Sarah finds is that roughly half have early formation. They formed incredibly early in the universe. And the other half have gone through a later event that changed the structure of the galaxy in the process of quenching. And so the key point here is, as observers, I can't just look at these images and say, oh, that must have been the early formation. So you have to look for some other observational clue. And one of the predictions that comes out of her work is that perhaps we could see if we could measure an age gradient. So within a single galaxy, measure the age in the center as a function of radius, you would expect that that early formation would have a relatively flat signature, whereas a central starburst would be younger in the center. And so I currently have a student who's working on developing this technique of extracting 2D spectra in using 3D HST data. So much like what I did before, but now extracting the centers of these galaxies and the outskirts, mostly for methodology, and we're going to use it on slightly different upcoming data sets. But also what I'm particularly excited about, so moving on, is this new observations that we have. So I might not have a lot of Patriots fans in the audience, but if you were watching the Super Bowl, no, anyone? Okay, one, Hubble was watching my observation. So it was an exciting day for me. And I am a Patriots fan, and I gave up, actually. I shouldn't have. So this is targeting down here. It's a gravitationally lensed, compact, quenching galaxy. So you see that it still has from its SED, it still has UV flux, but we've gone out and we've taken incredibly deep millimeter measurements to measure its gas content. There's very little gas. It's going to shut off. It has a very short time scale before it will be shutting off because it has no more fuel. And it has consistent with also an older population. So we have deep Hubble imaging to measure an age gradient of this single galaxy where you take advantage of the lensing, which makes it brighter and stretches it on the sky. So I'm particularly excited to see what comes out of this program. And then we also have, hopefully, some ALMA data that will be coming to get resolved, actually get the gas fraction, which we know is low, but we don't know how low. So my final slide is just saying that as someone who studies quiescent galaxies and someone who studies distant galaxies, it's a particularly exciting time with James Webb Space Telescope coming online. And so we just had the first official deadline related to JWST was last Friday, where you had to submit your notice of intent for the early release science teams. So it feels like it's really actually happening. So it's exciting for me knowing the capabilities that we have coming with the James Webb Space Telescope. And not to be forgotten, with all the work I've done with 3D HST, WFIRST is effectively an all-sky 3D HST. So there's a lot of interesting science you can do when you have the whole sky opened up instead of one teeny, small pointing into the universe. And then I've also been having fun working with working groups, learning about LUVOIR, which is something like a Keck in space. So in the 2030s, what's going to be the next generation? What are we going to build for then? So there's lots of, this may not be what happens, but it's fun to think of the science that you could do within my career. Okay. So my final slide is just summarizing these two questions. When does star formation quench? Redshift 2, the peak epoch of star formation, is really important for massive galaxies. And how are they growing over time? I would say stay tuned. I think that with coming technology and with creative techniques, we can learn a lot more about quenching and the actual connecting it to physical mechanisms and formation pathways for these galaxies. So I wanted to thank my collaborators, and most importantly, thank you. Thank you.
Great, so we have time for a few questions. Michael?
What sort of fraction of the mass of the universe is in these quiet galaxies?
So that's an interesting question. Most, I don't know the exact number, but most of the mass of the universe, mass, is in quiescent, massive galaxies. So by definition, most of them are quiescent, certainly in the nearby universe. It's a different question to what are the largest number by number of galaxies. That would be these dinky low-mass galaxies. But most of the mass of the universe is held up in massive galaxies. So it's how one could argue, do I care about the really faint but large by number low mass galaxies, or do I care about the very rare but massive galaxies? So I think it's like the competing, how you try to justify your science there.
Mass and stars, right?
Yeah. Well, also, I guess, sort of dark matter. Anyways.
I meant kilograms of protons and neutrons.
Protons and neutrons. Yeah. Well, most of the protons and neutrons are in gas.
I suppose I have a physics audience mostly here, so I should be careful how I interpret that.
Wade? I think you already answered it, but on that bimodal chart you had there, you had a very bright, heavy, you had the quiescent, some of those have lifetimes like 30 million years, essentially, big, bright, heavy stars.
the bright. So talking about.
You saw the star.
Stars that have usually very bright.
So for recently formed stars, yeah.
Blue stars.
Yeah.
They have like a 30 million year.
The stars themselves, yep.
Okay, so those galaxies that are bright, they're like 500 million years, right?
So.
And then if they do, then why don't they burn out?
So that's a good question, and the thing you need to remember is that whenever we look at a galaxy, we're looking at the light weighted. So what is the most luminous star in that galaxy, and it dominates the light that we see? Because we measure a spectrum, and we can only measure light. We can't measure mass. So there's an initial mass function for any given galaxy that has some distribution of stars that were formed in that star. So there's lots more low mass stars, kind of coming back to by galaxies. There's a lot more low mass stars, but they're incredibly faint, and that's why, but then there's very few rare, more massive, but incredibly luminous, these stars that are really short-lived. So they dominate the light when they're there, but when they fade away, that's why something looks like an elliptical galaxy. You don't have those really massive stars anymore. So you can finally see those lower mass, longer-lived stars. So it's a tricky thing, right, lifetime. So any star that ever formed, certainly for low-mass stars, they're still there in the galaxy, and there was some fraction of the galaxy that had low mass stars. They're not all gonna, it's not gonna exclusively make massive stars. So it's kind of, it comes back to the fact that it's a little bit tricky to define an age of a galaxy also. But I swept a lot of that under the rug.
Okay, I think we should thank Kate again.